On the behalf of organizers for today's event, that is the 9th Krishna Memorial Lecture, I extend a very warm welcome to the respected dignitaries, eminent teachers, colleagues and dear students who have assembled here and have graced the occasion with their presence. It is indeed a pleasure and an honor to state here that the event today has been jointly coordinated by different organizations working towards humanities, ethics, public health, research and social sciences, with the common goal of achieving comprehensive excellence in healthcare. May I introduce these organizations briefly? Anusandhan Trust is one of the organizers today. Was established in 1991 to establish and run democratically managed institutions to undertake research on health and allied fields. Cehat, that is Center for Enquiry into Health and Allied Themes, is a research center of Anusandhan Trust and focuses on social and public health research and policy advocacy. Dr. Manu P.L. Kothari, Chair of Medical Humanities, officially established in 2016, is the step towards inculcating in undergraduate and postgraduate medical students humanity, ethics, a love for philosophy and the arts, and while enriching their lives, simultaneously help them treat their patients with empathy and kindness. Students, please settle. Please settle down. The Forum for Medical Ethics Society was founded by a group of Mumbai-based medical practitioners in 1989. The primary agenda of this group was to highlight issues in medical ethics and generate discussions around them. It emerged from a unique combination of activism and education and sensitization at the interface of the healthcare system and society's needs. eSocial Sciences is one-stop portal for social scientists and provides a region-focused repository and a publication space for easy and quick dissemination of scholarly work that can be a space for discourse among researchers, policymakers, and the civil society. May I now call upon Dr. Padma Prakash, who will be speaking about Dr. Krishna Raj and his legacy. Dr. Padma Prakash is a founder trustee of Anusandhan Trust. She was with Economic and Political Weekly for many years and is currently the editor of eSocial Sciences and director Iris Knowledge Foundation. We welcome you, madam, to speak about Dr. Krishna.
Thank you. Well, friends, I welcome you again to the 9th Krishna Raj Memorial Lecture. Good to see all of you here. I am here to say a few words about the lecture series and about the Economic Political Weekly and Krishna Raj. And just to give you a background, to begin with, Anusandhan Trust instituted the lecture series in 2006, and for several reasons, and chief among them was that we wanted to honor the memory of Krishna Raj, whom all of us knew in different capacities. Krishna Raj was with the Economic and Political editor of the Economic Political Weekly for 35 years. The Economic Political Weekly is one of the is one of the foremost social science journals in India and the world over. It began life as Economic Weekly in 1949, and it was set up by Sachin Chaudhary, who thought that a newly democratic country needed a platform for public exchange and discussion. In 1966, it became the Economic and Political Weekly, and that's when Krishna Raj became the editor. For 35 years, he was its editor. The thing is, Economic Political Weekly it was run by a trust of very eminent people, but it is still run by a trust by very eminent people. But the point is that it had a lot of financial constraints. It didn't have any kind of financial support. Its only income came from small subscriptions and from small advertising, etc. And yet, every week it came out regularly. The unique thing about Economic Political Weekly is that it combines not just academic papers, but also a space for public debates. And this is the pattern that has continued all along. At the time that Krishna took over the Economic and Political Weekly, it was hard, not just in terms of finance, but it also in terms of getting articles. He had a hard time persuading people, persuading young scholars to publish with EW. And he became an expert at kind of persuading young people to publish in EW. Nobody could say no to him. And this also, he also became a mentor and a kind of guide to young scholars who wanted to write. And there are many today who will tell you, many eminent social scientists who will tell you that how they came to publish their first, you know, academic paper at the EPW and how much they owe to Krishnaraj. The thing is, in those years, there were years when, in the early years, there was a good staff with the EPW. But in later years, it became more and more difficult to have a editorial staff. And it was a long period in which Krishnaraj was almost alone in the editorial thing. And that was when he actually lived EPW, in a sense. And week after week, it came out and, which is why people do not know Krishnaraj very well, is because he spent all his time in the EPW. So, and of course, this was possible to a large extent because of the support and the encouragement of his spouse and his partner, Dr. Maitreyi Krishnaraj, who is herself an eminent scholar, a pioneering scholar in women's studies. Unfortunately, she's not here because she's not been keeping too well. But that is the essence of EPW, in the sense that it was all work. But at no time, I worked with him for 19 years, at no time was any visitor, refused, how should I say, audience with Krishnaraj. Whether it was a young student or an eminent scholar, regardless of social standing, regardless of ideological, background, everyone was welcome to EPW, and Krishnaraj would spend time with them, spend time with the visitors, even on days when, you know, we had to send the issue to press, and there was a lot, we had to send the issue to press for the evening. But he would be spending time with his visitors. And I think he gained a lot. I mean, this is how a journal has to grow. It has to grow not just because it is a space that where people come and publish. It is a journal, in EPW especially, was a journal which actually made people scholars, you know. And so he was a mentor and a guide to so many of us. And to this day, contributors will tell you how they kind of treasure the letters that he wrote to them, either to talk to them about their articles, or even to reject it. You know, I've heard people say, you know, I still treasure that letter that he wrote to me, rejecting my article. And, you know, that acquires a lot of significance today when we don't pay too much attention to writing letters and it's all email. So, it's something to be thought, we need to think about. So for many of us in the Anusandhan Trust, who had the privilege of being friends with him, his sudden passing was a shock. So we'd all known him in different capacities at different times, and we wanted to set up an annual event to commemorate his dedication and to set up a platform for public debate and discussion. Which is what he did with the EPW, so we thought we should continue with that kind of a tradition. The first Krishnaraj memorial oration was in 2006, and it was delivered by Aniruddha Krishna, who is a celebrated social scientist who had undertaken a remarkable, at that time, pretty controversial kind of work on issues of poverty and what role expenditure on food and medical care play in its persistence. This was followed by a series of public orations and a few seminars on a range of issues: equity in healthcare, clinical trials and medical ethics in healthcare, healthcare in states under siege, universal healthcare, rethinking of population education, and others. Well, some of these have prompted, sharp responses and critical debate. Others have been more, there has been a more ruminative understanding that has led to change. But in every case, these orations have been engaging and have brought onto public platforms issues that need to be debated and discussed. Our current oration by Dr. Pandya is on the issue that we have all been talking about for many years, the importance of understanding the complex and intriguing historical roots of medical care, medical education in India. If there is a lesson from Krishnaraj's life, it is this, that we need to give of ourselves and be willing to debate across ideologies, histories, and philosophies, and share our gained wisdom. Without this, there cannot be any growth in a democratic society. I now leave it to Dr. Sanjay Nagra to introduce. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for that wonderful and inspiring introduction. The chairperson for today's oration, our own director, Dr. Avinash Supay sir, has not been able to join us here, but he will be joining us shortly, because of some meeting here to go. It is indeed my privilege to introduce the discussant for today's oration, Dr. S.P. Kalantri. Dr. S.P. Kalantri is Director Professor of Medicine at the Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Medical Sciences and Medical Superintendent of Kasturba Hospital, Wardha. In 2004, he won Fogarty AIDS International Research Scholarship and obtained his Master's in Public Health Epidemiology from School of Public Health, University of California, Berkeley, at MGIMS. Besides teaching and managing the hospital, Dr. Kalantri also does clinical research in collaboration with University of California, Berkeley and McGill University, Canada. He successfully campaigned against sponsorship of medical conferences by the drug industry and introduced low-cost drugs in the hospital. The hospital information system that he has helped build has improved the quality and management of healthcare. Dr. Kalantri edited MFC Bulletin from 1989 to 92 and was associate editor of the Indian Journal of Medical Ethics from 2001 to 2004. We welcome you, sir, here. I will be introducing, it is indeed my honor to introduce Dr. Sanjay Nagaraj. He is a practicing surgeon with a special interest in hepato-pancreatobiliary surgery and liver transplantation. He did his undergraduate and postgraduate studies from this very institute, ZGS Medical College. And he has worked at KM Hospital, Mumbai till 1999 when he was associate professor of surgery. He did fellowships at the King's College Hospital and the Royal Free Hospital in London from 1995 to 1997. Currently, he is the director of the Department of Surgical Gastroenterology at Jaslok Hospital and also heads the Department of General Surgery at the KB Bhabha Municipal General Hospital. He has around 110 research publications in Index Journal and has written 4 textbook chapters. He has co-edited the book, Healers or Predators? Healthcare Corruption in India, along with Dr. Samiran Nandi and Keshav Desiraju, published by Oxford University Press in 2018. He was the Joint Secretary of the Zonal Transplant Coordination Committee based in Mumbai, which regulates cadaveric transplant activities in Mumbai. He has been nominated to the Executive Council of the Declaration of Istanbul Custodian Group, an international organization working on transplantation ethics. He is the publisher and member of editorial board of the Indian Journal of Medical Ethics and chairperson of the Forum for Medical Ethics. Dr. Sanjay Nagaraj regularly writes on issues related to public health, medical ethics, and organ transplantation. He has contributed to various publications, including the Times of India, Indian Express, Hindustan Times, Mumbai Mirror, Hindu, Economic and Political Weekly, etc. So we welcome you, sir, here. Dr. Nagra. And I request Dr. Nagra now to introduce the key speaker of today's oration, Dr. Sunil Pandya sir, and also talk about the history of medicine, the context.
So, let me begin by saying that as Swarupa told you, I was a student of this college and I spent a large part of my career in this institution. So, I have had many opportunities to be here on this podium, address varying types of audiences in this grand auditorium. But I think that today's occasion is exceptional for me. It is exceptional because today's event is a confluence of many organizations and personalities with whom I have had very old and very close connections. So first of all, of course, this institution where I, as I said, I spent a large part of my life and I keep on coming back at every small opportunity. The Forum for Medical Ethics, and as I was introduced, with whose journey I have been associated right from its inception. The Humanities Department of this college, which of course is a brainchild and of Dr. Pandya, Dr. Mehta, but I have had an opportunity to interact with them and be present in many of their events. And also the Anusandhan Trust and Cehat, which has seen many friends with whom we have done so much work together. And again, something that I have, an organization, an institution that I have witnessed right from its birth. And finally, Padma, the Economic and Political Weekly, where I did some of my early writing. And in fact, it was only when I wrote in the EPW that I sort of realized the kind of reach that magazine or a journal like EPW ad, because unlike some of the other writing which I do in various newspapers, which is read, opined upon, but this actually prompted often invitations that I got to deliver lectures. I got invitations to from government on some committees, etc. So it's an indication of the kind of audience that reads the EPW and the seriousness which it is taken. Now, I've been given two tasks for today, and they are extremely challenging tasks. The first is, as she said, setting the context for today's oration on history. And the second is introducing the orator, Dr. Sunil Pandya. And I'll tell you in a minute why these are very challenging tasks. So, the first task is the context of the oration and the history. The reason why I find this challenging is, number one, because I am not a student of medical history at all. Like many of you here, I occasionally read pieces on medical history, especially those which have some connection with my area of work. So I am not an expert in medical history, and therefore my thoughts would be rather simplistic. The second challenge, of course, is that your program should have to do it in 2 minutes. And that is going to be a challenge. So what I'm going to do is steal a little from the time allotted to me for the introduction and join it up with the part where I'm supposed to set the context so that I get a little more time to talk about the focus on history today. So the first thing that strikes me as a bit paradoxical is that an oration, the Krishnaraj Memorial Oration, the theme of the oration is contemporary issues in health and social sciences. So the first, it's a bit paradoxical that the oration which is focused on contemporary issues should go to history. But of course, there is a reason for that. So why should we, as practitioners, as participants in contemporary healthcare, why should we look back at what passed by, what happened many, many years back? Is it just an exercise in nostalgia? Is it just a kind of, you can say, an emotional trip? Or is there something more to it? And that, I think, is a question which kind of struck me as something that maybe I should address in a few minutes. Now, the usual reason that is advanced when anybody talks about why we should look back at history is this famous quote from George Santayana, and many of you have heard this quote in varying forms. This quote has been twisted around and the words have been changed, but essentially it said, those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. And in various ways this has been repeated. So if you don't learn from the mistakes and the errors of history, you are condemned to repeat those errors. So that's the classic reason why often we are exhorted to look back at history, and I think it's a very, very important reason. But I think when it comes to medicine and the history of medicine, there may be some more specific, perhaps some more very precise reasons why people attempt to go back and look at history. Now, I'm going to introduce Dr. Pandya, and of course in that context I'm going to talk about his writing on history. But I wonder what is it that prompted him to go back into history, because his other writing is on ethics. And therefore I personally think that there is a connection. And I think looking back at history by somebody who's an active medical professional is also a reflection of the fact that there is some trouble, something that is troubling the person, something that the person is reflecting upon. And I think this is one very important role of looking back at medical history. I think what it does is that it widens the sweep of our understanding of medicine. Besides that, I think when you go back to history, it necessarily points out to you the connections that the practice of healthcare and the practice of medicine has with events around in those epochs. So for example, the connection of medicine with war, with conflict, with famine, with migration, with natural disasters is brought out very well when you start looking back at history. So what it also does is, I think it is a reminder of the fact that medicine, healthcare, health sciences are on one hand a science, a pure science, a clinical science, but also are very strongly linked with social sciences. So I think history can be a vehicle as a reminder of this larger connection of medicine. And therefore, I also think that the study of history could be a small weapon, or even, let's say, a strategy to bring back humanities, as the department here is trying to do, social sciences, as some of the organizations involved in today's event have been attempting to do, ethics, because I think ethics is best talked about often in a historical sense. And therefore, in a sense, it is fitting and entirely relevant that 9 years after it was established, an oration which is supposed to focus on contemporary issues should take a break, pause, and choose to look back. And in that sense, I think the Krishnaraj Memorial Oration that is being delivered today is a bit different from what has been talked about in the previous orations. The second task I was given, which also is very challenging, is to introduce Dr. Pandya. I had the opportunity of introducing him last year in an event in the hospital that we worked together in. And when a problem with Dr. Pandya is that when you ask him for his CV, he sends you an extremely short CV, and with a further request which says that please be mercifully brief. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to largely honor your sentiment, but I'm going to circumvent the problem by not talking so much about him as a person, but sharing a little about some of the institutions that he has created, helped create and nurture, and some of his writing. So without dwelling on the personality, because I know he's very uncomfortable with that, I shall try and talk about some of his work. But let me first quickly read the official CV that he gives, because I think it's important to put that on the table to give the perspective, to locate him in terms of his career. So his official CV says that Dr. Sunil Pandya was appointed professor of neurosurgery at the Seth Gurdandas Sundardas Medical College in 1975 and retired on superannuation in 1998. He's an alumnus of Grand Medical College and Sir JJ Group of Hospitals, Mumbai, something that he's going to talk about today in his talk. He obtained his MBBS degree from the University of Mumbai in 1961 and MS in General Surgery in 1965. His training in neurosurgery was under the guidance and supervision of Dr. Gajendra Singh at JJ Hospital and Dr. Homi Dastur at KEM Hospital. Later, he pursued specialty training in the Institute of Neurology in London with Professor Valentin Locu and the Institute of Child Health in Great Ormond Street, London, with Drs. Kenneth Hill and Norman Grant. Dr. Pandya is a life member of the Neurological Society of India and the Asiatic Society of Mumbai. So that's what you get as his official CV when you ask him. But as I said, rather than me sort of waxing eloquent on his personality, I would spend the next few minutes talking to you about a few of the institutions that he has helped create. The first, and there are many young people here, some of you probably just entered medical college, and with time you will start seeing the speciality and super speciality departments of this hospital. But the first institution that Dr. Pandya has greatly contributed to is the Department of Neurosurgery of this hospital. Perhaps one of India's oldest, largest, and dare I say finest departments of neurosurgery, and I'm going to tell you soon why I think it is one of the finest. But it has trained a large number of neurosurgeons in this country. And if one goes across the country today, looking at leading leaders in the field of neurosurgery, many of them would be trained in this department. At once upon a time, this was probably one of the few departments in the country which was offering comprehensive postgraduate super specialty training in neurosurgery. But that's not why I think it was a fine or a unique department. I observed that department when I was across in the general surgery department, and I would meet Dr. Pandya very often because we at that time were in the process of setting up the Indian Journal of Medical Ethics, which I'm going to talk about in a minute. But I think it was a fine department because, number one, the staff of that department, and I'm talking of the professors, and some of you would have witnessed this, work from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., well beyond official hours. They were all there. They were all there till the evenings. All the three senior professors were big names now in their respective field, worked together in great harmony, and they split their areas of specialization. There was no separate office for the head of the department. So there was a big office where everybody sat, all everybody together, and including the resident doctors and the junior staff. In the OPD, everybody sat at a large table, so everybody was together. There was no jumping of queue for anyone, even those with a note from the dean or any minister. There was a clear rule in that department, no jumping of queues, whatever the note comes from. All ward rounds were typed in. Remember, we are talking of the 1970s and 80s, were typed in after the round, dictated, and all filed together, the pre-computer era, filed together in big box files which lined the office of the Department of Neurosurgery. And if you ever went there out of interest for some form of data and research, all you had to do is ask them about a particular disease, and within minutes, because it was all classified based on name and diseases, a huge cupboard, and within minutes they could procure it for you. So in the pre-digital era, this was a department which had one of the finest set of records. So when I say that this was a fine department, what I What I mean is that it was very unique in these respects, and that partly reflects Dr. Pandya's personality. The other institution he helped create, and which I have had the great fortune of being a part of that journey, was what is now called the Indian Journal of Medical Ethics, but what started as a small little sort of bulletin called Issues in Medical Ethics. 1992, the office of the Department of Neurosurgery, every day after work, Dr. Pandya would sit in the small room with his computer or typewriter, work till the night and produce a bulletin. But the most important part, and this is where I think there is some similarity to EPWs, that not a single issue missed, not a single issue late. And in fact, one of the key strengths of this journal over the years, and now it's now more than two decades, is the fact that it has come out with amazing regularity and amazingly on time. And this also led to it being recognized. It was soon indexed on PubMed, and now, of course, is perhaps the leading journal of its kind, at least from this part of the world, South Asia. Lots of recognition, lots of contributions, and it's expanded in a big way. And some of you, of course, may have had a chance to look at the copies that have kept outside. If not, perhaps you should do that after the meeting. The final aspect of Dr. Pandya, which I'm going to briefly touch upon, is him as a writer. And he's written on three areas. Neurosurgery, which of course was his specialization. The history of medicine, which he's going to talk to us about today. And ethics. But if you actually look at what he's written, it's often a combination of all these three things. He's written on the history of neurosurgery. He's written on ethics in neurosurgery. So it's actually all three, these three areas, which is sort of have engaged his mind over the last many decades. It all started way back in 1969, so it's a very early interest, because his first article on Have Kushing, and some of you already probably know about him, if not, you'll soon know about him, Neurology India 1969, Have Kushing, the Man and His Literary Contributions. So I think it must have been very, very early in his career when people are typically writing some kind of research stuff, some clinical sort of case reports. Dr. Pandya was writing about Cushing. Soon he started writing more and more, and I think his writings are in three or four, can be classified in three or four areas. The first is biographical pieces. So he's written largely about neurosurgeons, neurologists, but also about figures who are all around you in this area. So Dr. Charles Moret, and I think he's probably going to refer to that in his talk. So he has a piece called Dr. Charles Moret, Pioneer in Medical Education in Journal of Medical Biography. He wrote about disease, but from a historical viewpoint. So a piece in 1970 called John Hilton's Contributions on Atlanto-Axial Disease, a forgotten chapter in the history of neurosurgery. So again, disease, but with a historical context. And finally, pieces like Medicine in Goa, a former Portuguese territory, Journal of Postgraduate Medicine, 1982. And his last, one of his last writings, which is an obituary, is just published 2018, Neurology India, and this is for none other than Sir Roger Bannister, and some of you probably know that Sir Roger was, of course, a doctor, a neurologist, I think. But we know him for him, know about him more as an athlete. And I think one of the first athletes to break the mile record. So his last piece is an obituary for the Sir Roger Bannister. And before I conclude, I want to also tell you that the topic that he is going to cover today, Dr. Pandya has been attempting for many years to put it together in the form of a book. Knowing him, knowing his rather reticent, shy side, I think he's had some difficulties for some time getting it published, but he just informed me yesterday, and I think this is perhaps, if I may be allowed to share this with everybody here, it's perhaps the best occasion to announce it, that his work on the JJ Hospital is going to be coming out in the form of an entire book. And this will be soon published by Cambridge Scholar. So in the near future, you will see this in the form of a book. So I thought I'd take the opportunity to announce this. So with this introduction, and I hope Dr. Pandya have not transgressed the line, I have not talked too much about you, but about the work you have done, may I now, ladies and gentlemen, invite Dr. Sunil Pandya.
As usual, Dr. Sanjay Nagwal has been very generous in his praise. I have to first of all start with a disclaimer. The Department of Neurosurgery at the KEM is what it is today, not because of me, but because of the person who founded it, and that was Dr. Homi Dastur. He had studied neurosurgery in Britain with a very, very eminent neurosurgeon of that time who eventually was knighted. So he became Sir Wiley McKissack, and that was Dr. Dastur's teacher. And Dr. Dastur brought everything that was good in that department to the KEM. And all that we did was just to continue what he had started. So I don't think we deserve any praise for that. He was quite right when he said that we share an experience with Mr. Krishna Raj, Dr. Krishna Raj, and that is the difficulty that we had when we started preparing what eventually became the Indian Journal of Medical Ethics. We went through the same kind of experiences that he went through. And so we understand what he went through. Today's talk is going to be an exercise in understanding the fate of institutions over time. What happens when an institution like the Grand Medical College and the Jamsetjee Jejeebhoy Hospital, which was started in 1845, what happened to these institutions over the next 50 years, 100 years, 150 years, whatever? And so this is an attempt at trying to understand the fluctuations that occur in the fate of medical institutions anywhere, but specifically referring to these institutions, which are our sister institutions as far as the GS Medical College and the KEM Hospital are concerned. The first question is, at that time you will remember that the country was being ruled, large parts of the country were being ruled by what was known as the East India Company. And the Great Britain of the 1800s, 1820, 1840 had no established policy that the government was responsible for higher education. They were supposed to look after the primary education of its citizens, but nothing much beyond that. There was no organized, government-regulated higher education. And so naturally, the East India Company, which was a trading company when it came to India, was also not interested in introducing any kind of higher education in India. So why then did the East India Company set up institutions to teach medicine to Indians? They used to refer to us as natives, not in a derogatory sense, but to differentiate us from them. So that is how they used to call us natives. So why did the East India Company start institutions to teach modern medicine, scientific medicine, to Indians? And that started around the 1820s. And this slide tells you how and why that happened. And that happened because the director of the board of the East India Company in London, whose name was Charles Grant, it so happens that we are going to refer to his son in a very big way in a few minutes. So it was the father, Charles Grant, who made the board pass a regulation for the East India Company in India, saying that you will spend from the income that you get every year, the sum of rupees 100,000, 1 lakh of rupees, for introducing education of the natives in the sciences. Now, today we may think that 100,000 is chicken feed, because we now talk of thousands of crores in scams. But at that time, 100,000 meant a lot of money, a tremendous amount of money, because the salaries at that time were 200, 300 for those who were very well placed. So this amount was a huge amount of money. And Charles Grant and the board of the East India Company directed the Governor General, who was based in Calcutta, to spend this sum compulsorily every year for this purpose. Now, as a result of that, when Lord Bentinck was the Governor General in Calcutta, he set the ball rolling for starting a medical school in Calcutta in 1822. Around that time, Bombay had a very far-sighted governor, and his name was Mountstuart Elphinstone. I could talk for 1 hour just on Mountstuart Elphinstone, but I'll give up that temptation in the interest of time and proceed to the next step, which is the step that he took in January 1826, when he decided that Bombay must have a medical school. And please note this part, that school should enable Indians to serve their countrymen as physicians and surgeons. Now, this was different from what obtained in Calcutta. The Calcutta school was set up so that they would produce attendants who would help British doctors who were looking after Indians under the government employ. So every presidency, we had the Bombay presidency, the Calcutta presidency, the Madras presidency. Every presidency had an army. And of course, there was a government in every presidency. And these people employed Indians. And when these Indians fell sick, they had to be looked after. And they found that getting British doctors to look after Indian sick was a waste of the time of British doctors. So they decided to employ individuals who would be attendants, who would work under the guidance of the British doctors and who would look after the Indians who were in government employ. But the school envisaged in Bombay was different. It was meant to produce doctors who will go out fully trained and who will treat their countrymen in the presidency, not government employees. Unfortunately, Calcutta was in the commanding situation, and Calcutta dictated, no, you will follow the pattern which we have set up over here. So willy-nilly, Elphinstone had to toe the line, and he had also to set up his school in such a way that it would produce not full-fledged doctors, but attendants who would work under British supervision. You will note the last line, which is very telling. The government at that time believed that we need their hands, not their heads. What Elphinstone did was to ask a very promising young doctor in the Bombay presidency to form this school. There was no school. This was the first school that was to be formed. And his name was John McLennan. We have no portrait of John McLennan. This is the only image that I can find after years and years and years of search. And this is on the McLennan Medal, which was awarded by the Grand Medical College many years later. Now, these are the conditions under which McLennan was told to teach students medicine. he had a total staff of four. And of these four, two were munshis and one was a pune. So the only medical person on that staff was McLennan himself. He was told that you have to teach anyone above the age of 12 who comes to you for education. So he had to start with individuals who were 12 years old. And he was told that you will teach them in their native languages. So Marathi, Gujarati, you teach them in those languages. There were no books in Marathi or in Gujarati or in any other Indian language that he could use. So he had to get books from England and translate them and prepare translations which would be used to teach these students. Finally, there was no hospital attached. So neither he nor his students had any access to patients. So all the education was all theoretical education. These are some of the books which McLennan published. And these books, fortunately for us, are available even today. If you go just a little bit further south to Dadar, you will find this Mumbai Marathi Granth Sangrahalaya. And there you will see these copies of these books. You can go there even today and you can have a look at them. And these books were in use even after this medical school was abolished. Because if you look at the last book, you will find that it is published in 1852, the book which is on your extreme right-hand side. Now, after a few years, a review was made of the functions of this school. What did it achieve during those few years? By that time, Elphinstone had gone, and there was a new governor in Bombay. And the medical board under this new governor came to the conclusion that the school was a dismal failure. It had achieved nothing. And the even more tragic conclusion that they came to was medical knowledge is not communicable to the natives of this country. They cannot be taught medicine. They are incapable of learning medicine. And therefore, this school should be abolished. And so it was. It was abolished in the year 1832 after it had been in existence for 6 years. Now, this failure was to prove a big stumbling block when Sir Robert Grant came on the scene. This is Sir Robert Grant, the son of Charles Grant, you remember, who had granted a lakh of rupees for the education of Indians every year. This is his son. And when he died, the Bishop of Calcutta, who was a very close friend of the family, he knew Charles Grant, he knew Robert Grant, Robert Grant's brother, he knew the family from England. He made this statement at the ceremony which was held to condole the death of Robert Grant. He said, "No object was dearer to his heart than to form a school of native medical youth." But the last part of this sentence is even more important. This school, which Robert Grant wanted to found, had to be in all the last European improvement of the humane and noble science. It had to be of the highest standards that were available in Europe at that time. This is the school which Robert Grant envisaged. Now, naturally, as soon as he started studying this, he developed this concept that he had that we must set up this kind of a school. And in 1837, he describes in a minute, and a copy of that minute is available in the Department of Archives, Government of Maharashtra, in the Elphinstone College. In his own handwriting, he writes that when I was at the Mahabaleshwar Hills in the year 1835, I suggested to my physician, Dr. Moorhead, that we must start an institution to teach Indians medical science. The very next paragraph says, I know that this experiment had been tried and it failed. But I have studied all the documents pertaining to that school with great care. And I have come to the conclusion that the object is not of hopeless attainment. In spite of the conclusion that had been drawn that Indians are incapable of learning medicine, Robert Grant said, no, I don't agree with that conclusion. So he told Charles Moorhead, please go ahead and do whatever is required to start a new medical school. And now we have an object lesson which is very pertinent today. Remember, the governor of Bombay Presidency was a very powerful man. Bombay Presidency at that time extended from parts of Pakistan today, that means Karachi and that area, down to parts of what are today Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. All this was Bombay Presidency, and he was the command, the boss of this presidency. He could have just issued a fiat, let's start a medical college, but he didn't do that. What he said was, let's go step by step and see how we can put this project into operation. So what was the first step? The first step was to send a questionnaire. And this questionnaire is 4 pages long. And it has a number of questions. And this questionnaire was sent to all these people who are listed over there. It was sent to surgeons, it was sent to vaccinators, but it was also sent to eminent natives who were literate and who were able to understand what was being asked and give cogent replies. So he sent them to principals of schools who were of Indian origin. And all this questionnaire was intended to do was to elicit information. And many, many, many questions were asked. In your area, in your zone, in your district, in your village, in your town, what is the existing state of medical practice? How is medical education being carried out at the moment? Who teaches? Who are the students? What are the methods of teaching? What kind of books do they have which the students can refer to? And so on, exhaustive. If we want to introduce Western medical education, will Indians accept it or will they reject it? In your opinion, and this particularly has to all the teachers, the Indian teachers who were heads of Indian teaching institutions, in your opinion, do you think that your students will be able to learn modern Western medicine? And all these exhaustive questions, they collated the replies which came from all over the presidency. And this was the finding, the gist of the findings of that survey. The first statement that they made was that the system of medical education amongst the natives is very haphazard. In some cases, it is from father to son. So the father who's a waiz or a hakim teaches his son and he teaches his son and so on. It's a practice which runs in the family. Another way of getting medical education was to become an apprentice. So you enter the house of the waiz or the hakim and you do all the menial tasks, cleaning the floor, washing the clothes, cooking the food, all the rubbish work. And in return, the waiz or the hakim would impart education to you over some years. Books were very, very scarce, hardly any available. And in any case, those books were useless because most of the waids and hakims and the people who wanted to study with them were illiterate. They didn't know how to read. So books were really of no value. Now, you might feel that this is a kind of a biased study, because it was carried out by Britishers who had a motive. The motive was to start a medical school. But an independent study was carried out by Dr. Sakaram Arjun, who, as it happens, was a graduate of the Grand Medical College. And this independent study was carried out almost 50 years later, in 1883, on his own. And he found that the conditions were exactly the same as they were in 1837. And Sakaram Arjun has published a detailed paper with a description of his own findings. So the situation had not changed as far as education of Indians by Indians was concerned outside the British system for 50 years. And these were the conclusions that they came from the survey. First of all, the establishment of a medical school is practical and is advisable. Then came a very crucial statement. Medical education can only be conducted by approximating as nearly as possible the systems of instructions followed in Europe. The standards must be as high as in any medical school in Europe. You cannot have a second-class education for Indians. And thirdly, we want to educate students not to become government servants, but to become independent practitioners. The view that Elphinstone had propagated in the beginning, but Elphinstone had been overruled. And now this committee, probably at the prodding of Robert Brown, probably at the prodding of Moorhead, we don't know, they came out with the same kind of a proposal. And this was a big departure, because by that time, there were two medical schools in India outside Bombay, one in Calcutta, one in Madras. And both those schools were only to educate servants for use by the British to treat Indians under their employment. So this was a radical departure from what was in existence in Calcutta and in Madras. On the basis of this collated findings of the survey, Sir Robert Grant proposed the formation of a medical college in Bombay. There were some hazards, but we won't go into those. And Jamsetjee Jejeebhoy, who was a very prominent merchant in Bombay, learned of this proposal. And when he learned that this proposal had been made, he instantly offered a grant of 100,000 rupees. Remember, this is 1830s. 100,000 rupees is a lot of money. For the creation of a hospital which would be set up side by side with the medical college. Remember, McLennan's school had no access to a hospital. They had no patients. Theoretical teaching. Jamsetjee Jejeebhoy said, no, if you're going to have a medical college, you must have a hospital. And so he set up at single individual's expense, one person set up an entire hospital to go with the medical college. I don't know of any other example, certainly in this country and maybe not in many, many other countries, where one man has donated an entire hospital to a medical college. And this is subject Sir Jamsetjee Jejeebhoy. In 1838, after a considerable amount of time had passed, papers were going from Bombay to Calcutta. Remember, at that time, there was no telephone, telegraph, nothing. So a paper which had to go from Bombay to Calcutta would take 8 days, 10 days, 15 days. For a reply to come from Calcutta would take another 10, 15 days. Calcutta did not have the final authority. They had to send papers to London. So they had to go by steamship to London. And then from there, the steamship reply would come to Calcutta. And then from there, the reply would be transmitted to Bombay. So it took a lot of time getting any kind of decisions or making any kind of proposal, discussion, whatever. So it took time. And in 1838, Sir Robert Grant wrote this as part of his minute. And I think this is one of the most premonitory minutes that has ever been made in history. Because he wrote, he kept on pushing his bureaucrats, what's happening about our proposal to the medical college? And he said, look, I'm sorry, I'm being impatient, I'm being precipitate. But in this country, you can never know what's going to happen tomorrow. Everything is precipitate. And I'm anxious to quickly find out whether Calcutta is willing to sanction. Because if Calcutta sanctions it, we still have to wait for England to sanction it. And this he wrote in 1838. in April, and in June, while he was at Dapuri, which is near Pune, which was a kind of summer government area for the government of Bombay, Sir Robert Grant suffered a massive hemorrhage in the brain and he died. He died before he could know what is happening to his proposals. Now, in July, George Eden, who was the Governor General in Calcutta at that time, sanctioned the formation of this medical college. And at a public meeting which was held to commemorate the death, I mean to condole the death of Sir Robert Grant, Nana Sankarshit, Nana Chowk, named after Nana Sankarshit, who was a very, very prominent citizen of Bombay, he proposed that this college should be named after Sir Robert Grant, who had so ably and enthusiastically planned it and zealously advocated its cause. And so at last, after so many years of effort by Sir Robert Grant and Morehead and by their team, the foundation was laid by Daniel, Lord Bishop of Calcutta. He's the person, you remember, I showed you that little quotation about what Grant wanted. And the Grand Medical College opened in 1845. There were complaints in the Times of India that the foundation stone had been laid in 43. It took 2 years for you to start the medical college and the hospital. But it took, I mean, it did take. But there were complaints in the Times of India of that time. And these were the first three professors. And Dr. Charles Morehead, who had helped Sir Robert Grant in order to get this college into being, was a professor of medicine and the first principal of the college. This is how these institutions looked like in those days. On your left-hand side, you see the college. And on your right-hand side, at the back, in the background, you see Sir Jamsetjee Jejeebhoy's hospital, the creation of one man. The hospital had been demolished. Unfortunately, it's gone. In its place, there is a six-storied building now. But the college building is still preserving. It's still preserved, it's still there, existing, but in a terrible state. Dilapidated, nobody interested in its management, till very, very recently, when some modifications have been made. This is another view of those same institutions. On your left, this is seen from the side. It is seen from the south end of the compound. And on your left side is the college, and on your right hand side is the hospital. And in between, there's a body of water, and that is the Babula tank. The Babula tank is gone, but the Babula tank road is still there, even today. This is a fresh water tank, and it was supposed to be the biggest tank in Bombay supplying fresh water to citizens, till around 1947, 48, 49, when there are letters to the editor in the Times of India about how this tank has got polluted by people dumping all kinds of garbage, excreta into the tank and making it one of the filthiest tanks in town. And probably for that reason, the tank was eventually filled up. Now, I want to focus on the quality of education which was to be imparted in the Grand Medical College from day one, before the students entered the medical college and as soon as they entered medical college. This is only part of the regulations. The regulations are about 2 pages long. Admission to these institutions were to be made without any acknowledgement to the dictates of caste or creed. It didn't matter what caste you belonged to, it didn't matter what religion you followed. You could apply for admission. The medium of instruction, see, they learned. They learned from the mistakes that had been made when the school was started by Elphinstone. The medium of instruction was English, no vernacular languages. Not only was it to be in English, but the students who applied were examined in their proficiency in English, and they had to be able to understand, read and write fluently. Only then would they be considered for admission. An admission was after examination by representatives of the medical board, Board of Education. The Board of Education was in overall charge of education in the entire city. And there were two classes of students, free and stipendary. Stipendary means the student was paid to become a medical student, because there was great fear that Indian students would not join the medical college. There was such a big taboo against dissection, against dealing with the sick, against exposure to pus and urine and feces, that they were worried whether students will come at all to the medical college. So they offered stipends, they paid students to come, but the paid seats were limited and the rest could be free. The course of studies in England at that time, the course of studies varied from 2 to 3 years. In England, in British universities, course of study 2 years, 3 years, very variable. Students may attend, may not attend, very irregular. Here it was made compulsory, not less than 4 years. And the final examination at the end of the course would be conducted by external experts, not the teachers, but by external experts drawn from the medical services and were nominated by the Board of Education. So these were the precautions that they took right at the start when this college was started. And this is a very brief kind of summary of the course of studies that they had to go through. They had to attend college from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. and they were very closely supervised. There was an exhaustive coverage of the topics, subjects by the teacher. And I've given you two examples, bottom right-hand side. Lectures per year in anatomy, 123 lectures per year. Lectures in chemistry, 111 lectures per year. And similarly for medicine and similarly for the other subjects. And the table on the right shows you how the who gave the lectures and what the kind of teaching was. Now, as soon as the student reached the second year, compulsory attendance at the hospital from the second year onwards. And from the moment the student entered the hospital, the emphasis was on learning at the bedside of the patient. Not from books. Of course you had to learn from books, but that was not the important thing. The important thing was to learn at the bedside of the patient. Now, if you talk to any historian of medicine from abroad, they will tell you that the champion of bedside teaching of medicine is Sir William Osler. Sir William Osler was a Canadian who went to America, became the first professor of medicine at Johns Hopkins, then went to Oxford where he was Regius Professor of Medicine in Oxford. They will all tell you that it is William Osler who started bedside teaching. But William Osler was born in 1849. Morehead had started these practices in 1845, 46, 47. Osler was not even born at that time. And that, of course, the Western historical experts are not aware of, unfortunately. Now, this is the manner in which students were taught. At every lecture, and in each hospital clinic, there were roll calls. And if a student persistently did not attend, then he would be hauled up and he would be threatened with being rusticated. When not attending lectures or demonstrations, they had to read and they had to make notes. But these notes were under the supervision of the teachers. And the teacher would then go through the notes that were made and point out errors and suggest corrections. I mean, this was, it was actually like school teaching, like a small school child being taught. And in fact, Moorhead and many of his colleagues write that, that we have to do this because these students have never been exposed to this kind of teaching so far. They have been exposed to a completely different variety of teaching. And so we have to instill the sense of discipline as regards studies. And only then can we succeed. Every week, there were YOBOC examinations to check whether the students understood what had been taught and whether they remembered what had been taught the previous session or the session before that. All notes were checked and corrected by the teachers. So this was from 1845 onwards. There is much more, but we don't have time to go into that. And in 1851, external examiners examined the candidates and they announced the names of the successful candidates, and these were the successful candidates. Of these, I'm going to particularly pay attention to number four, and that is Bhavdaji. There's a reason why I'm paying this attention. When the medical course was completed and the graduates came out, Moorhead and his colleagues realized that they may not get any practice at all. They've just come out of medical college, they will starve. So they created posts which were called sub-assistant surgeons. And they would be paid a stipend and they would serve in the Grand Medical College, JJ Hospital, till they could set up independent practice of their own. And some of these students did make use of that sub-assistant surgeon's post for a short time, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. But Bhavdaji didn't go into the sub-assistant surgeon's post at all. He started practice as soon as he came out of the Grand Medical College. And within 3 years, he had a practice which was greater than the practice of the British doctors practicing medicine in Bombay. Amazing man. He's amazing for many, many other things also, for his study of history, for his study of coins, of engravings, carvings all over India, many multifaceted person. Now, when they passed, the qualification that they got was graduate of the Grand Medical College. There was no University of Bombay at that time. So the qualification was GGMC. And this is what the GGMC certificate looked like. This is a certificate which was awarded to Atmaram Pandurang. This used to hang on one of the walls of the college library for many, many, many years. And this photograph was taken by us around 1961, 62. Unfortunately, that photograph, I mean the certificate has disappeared from there because the library was shifted from this particular area to a new building. And nobody knows where this certificate has gone. So I can't take a better photograph. It's the only photograph I have. This photograph of Atmaram Pandurang, which you see on the top left-hand side, was obviously not there on the certificate. It has been put by the relatives of Atmaram Pandurang. And the quality of this photograph is very poor. But even then, if you look at the bottom, right in the center, you will see the signature of Dr. Charles Moorhead, MD. You can just about make it out. You can't make out the signature to the right of Moorhead's signature, but that is the signature of John McLennan. And McLennan was the chairman of the Board of Examiners. McLennan, you will remember, is the person who was asked to start the medical school, which failed. By that time, McLennan was Surgeon General in the government of Bombay. And the certificate stated what I have listed on the right, because you can't read it. The print is so bad, the photograph is so bad that you can't read it. So I've told you what that certificate says on the right, that these students have been examined in anatomy, physiology, materia medica, pharmacy, botany, and they were also examined clinically in medicine, surgery, midwifery, and medical jurisprudence. The examination lasted 10 days. 10 days. And the clinical assessment was carried out by these external examiners on ward rounds of the hospital. Not short case, long case, on patients individually, till they were satisfied that this boy knows what he's talking about. So very exhaustive, very, very detailed examination was carried out. This examination was carried out in 1851. In 1855, 4 years later, the British journal, The Lancet, featured Dr. Bhav Daji under sketch of an Indian physician. And the print is too small for you to read, and it's too much to read. But it is full of praise for Bhav Daji. The British journal, The Lancet, not used to praising Indians, and yet there it is, 4 years after Bhav Daji had graduated. Now, under this kind of regimen, with this kind of strict discipline, and with this kind of intensive training, the college soon gained a very high reputation. But after 1861, there were some events. And these events brought down the reputation of these institutions a bit. Now, these were the developments from 1857 onwards. The first development was not a bad development, it was a good development. And that was the foundation of the University of Bombay in 1857. 1857, you remember, is the time when there was a revolt against the British government, the rebellion against the British government. And as a consequence of that, the East India Company was abolished, and the government of Great Britain took over the government of India and appointed a viceroy instead of the Governor General. The examination, which used to be conducted by the medical board for admission to Grand Medical College, was now conducted by the University of Bombay. And the minimum qualification required to become a medical student was the matriculation examination of the University of Bombay. And the medical degree which was awarded was not GGMC anymore, but it was LM, Licentiate in Medicine. It changed over the years. It became LMNS, and finally it became MBBS. In 1861, in spite of the protests of Dr. Charles Moorhead, a vernacular class was installed in the Grand Medical College, both in Marathi and in Gujarati. Moorhead protested, "We've gone through this exercise. It has failed. We can't teach in Marathi and Gujarati. There are no texts available. There are no teachers who have the skills to teach in Marathi and Gujarati," but they were overruled. And these classes were started. Another set of classes were started for people who were intended to serve as attendants in military hospitals. This is exactly what Grant, Elphinston, Grant, and Moorhead had protested. We don't want to create a class of servants. We want to create a class of independent doctors. Instead of that, they introduced this class. And finally, we have on record in the archives and in the Times of India columns that professors at the Grand Medical College were now allowed private practice. Moorhead was also allowed private practice, but he preferred to pay more attention to the college than to his private practice. The emphasis had shifted from college to private practice. And because it had shifted, teaching and care of the patients took a nosedive. Dr. Sylvester, who succeeded Moorhead after some generations, in 1872-73 was the acting principal, and in the annual report of the college, this is what he wrote. Moorhead had gone to England in 1861, and he had settled in Edinburgh. you're no more in any way officially connected with the Grand Medical College. But he continued to show a lot of interest in the progress of the medical college and kept himself abreast of what was going on in the medical college. This is what Sylvester wrote about Morehead. Morehead went away in 1861. This is what he writes in 72. Morehead may be called the pioneer of medical education in this country. Not one of his successors has ever labored here as he did. He was an enthusiast. His objection to the vernacular incubus, I believe, is well founded. And Sylvester wrote that because of these classes, we don't have enough space in the college because we now have to cater to all these other classes. And Morehead himself wrote to one of his colleagues in 1877, 2 years after Sylvester's note, "The college as a practical school of medicine is in a rotten condition, with little chance of being recovered from it." And then he writes a heart-rending statement. "It is not pleasant to have your garden of roses being plowed, harrowed over, and planted with hemlock and thistles." This is what he felt. And he wrote towards the end of this letter, "I feel that the present method of Indian education and policy is too much claptrap, too much of the fashion of the hippodrome and the pantomime, too much of natak, not much substance." I'm afraid this comment which he made is valid even today. But the fortunes of institutions wax and wane. And so over time, there were other professors and other principals who came in who salvaged the reputation of these institutions. The government withdrew these vernacular classes and these classes for attendance in military hospitals because they realized that this was stupidity. And there were principals and professors like, I'm just using a few names, just a handful of, there were many of them, like Henry Van Dyke Carter, and there were Indians, like Dr. Surveyor Raghavendra Rao, Major S.L. Bhatia, who later on became Major General S.L. Bhatia, and Jamsetjee Dagan. And these British and Indians on the staff of these institutions gradually elevated the reputation of these institutions. So in 1903, the Times of India wrote, "The high reputation of the college and hospital is just merited." This was 1903. After that, the college continued to retain a fairly high reputation till around 1965, 1967, when again the rot set in. And that has led to the sorry state of affairs which we see today. What is the cause of this present sorry state? In my opinion, these are important causes. And the first and the most important is that merit is not the sole criterion for selection, appointments, promotions, awards. There cannot be any other criterion except merit. If you want an institution to rise and develop, merit and merit alone should be the criterion. Unfortunately, that is no more valid. Then there is the terrible effect of reservations on caste. Whilst you might justify reservations on caste in primary schools and secondary schools and maybe even primary colleges, by no stretch of imagination can you justify reservations at the level of professorial posts. These posts can only be on merit, they cannot be on any other basis. And then there is this terrible, terrible effect of political interference and the use of the weapon of transfer. So if I, as a professor in the Grand Medical College in Bombay, do something which displeases the minister or the secretary in the Ministry of Health, I can be transferred to Ambejogai overnight. No tomorrow morning I'll be issued orders. You have been transferred to Ambedkar. And you can imagine what this does to the morale of the teachers in the institution. And it is the teachers who make the institution. Not buildings, not equipment, it's the human beings. And if you drop the morale of these people, the institution cannot thrive, it cannot flourish. So, on balance, today, and luckily for me, as I was wondering how I should phrase this, in the Hindustan Times this morning, Dr. Gopal Krishna Gandhi has written a lovely essay on institution, and he ends that essay in this manner. So I've taken his statement in the Hindustan Times this morning and put it here. On balance, where do these institutions stand? Proud of their past, uneasy in their present, uncertain about their future. They stand on uncertain feet where faith and fear meet. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for this wonderful speech. And you have really taken us back into the history through this such a beautiful and wonderful speech, sir, really. Dr. Nagaraj has already spoken about sir's contributions. And to add further, Dr. Pandya is chairperson of Dr. MBLK, chair of Medical Humanities, Division of Humanities of this institution.
I'm just going to take 2 minutes of your time. This city has been very fortunate in having as founder principals not one man, but two people. One, of course, was Dr. Charles Moorhead at Baikala. But in this place, we had another man right on top there. You can see his portrait, Dr. Jivraj Mehta. Like Dr. Moorhead, Dr. Jivraj Mehta used to supervise every aspect of the functioning of this hospital and medical college. I'll give you only one example. He would come 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock at night. He lived on Carmichael Road. He had a flat on Carmichael Road. I've been to that flat. I was fortunate. I was also fortunate in order to be able to meet him and talk to him. He told me, he used to come around 1 o'clock, park his car at the College of Physicians and Surgeons, which is 100 yards away from here. Because if he parked his car here, everybody would know that the dean has come. So he would park his car there. Now, all those of you who are working in this hospital, you know that at the back end of the hospital, there are spiral staircases. That spiral staircase leads to the entrance to each ward. If you climb that spiral staircase, the first thing you will see is the toilet. And so he would climb the staircase and he would first go into the toilet and see how clean it was. He would note each deficiency that he noted. He would then go into the ward. 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning, everything is dark. He would see what the nurse is doing. He would walk up to that nurse. And then he would say, please show me the call book. At that time, we used to have call books because we didn't have mobile phones and we didn't have all those facilities. So whenever a patient's condition worsened, an entry would be made by the nurse in a call book, and the call book would be sent to the relevant doctor, registrar, husband, whoever it was. Time was noted. Time, this is sent at 10 or 11 p.m. or 9 p.m. or whatever. And when the doctor saw that call book, he was supposed to sign that I've seen this call at 10 past 9. And then when he came to the ward, he was supposed to deal with the patient and write his notes on the paper and sign what time. So Jivraj Mehta would check when was the call sent, when did this doctor attend. And if that doctor had attended more than 15 to 20 minutes later, tomorrow morning, he would be summoned to the dean's office and be given a real dressing down this call was sent because the patient's condition is bad. Why is it that you delayed attending to this patient? So, this city has been very fortunate. Both the Grand Medical and the GS Medical College had founders who were superb. That is why these institutions gained the reputation that they did. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It is really wonderful to know about the dedication, the diligence, and the contributions of these eminent personalities because of whom we are here today. And now it's a pleasure that the chairperson for today's event and our very own director, Dr. Avinash Supre, sir, is here with us now. Sir is the Dean of KM Hospital and St. GS Medical College. In 2016, he was... okay, sir. So, just to announce, he has... in 2016, he was also appointed the Director of Medical Education and Major Hospitals of Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai. He has practiced as a surgical gastroenterologist and has also been a consultant with the Medical Council of India for curriculum development and has co-chaired the Department of Medical Education with the Maharashtra University of Health Sciences. He is the recipient of over 40 national and international awards, several publications, fellowships and medals. He has also held the International College of Surgeons Fellowship and was trained at the Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York. Most recently, he has received the prestigious Dr. B.C. Roy National Award given by the Medical Council of India for his outstanding performance as a medical teacher. The award will be presented by Honorable President Dr. Ramnath Kovind in New Delhi. We take this opportunity to congratulate sir from all of us. And now I request sir to offer his remarks as the chairperson.
Respected Dr. Pandya, all the dignitaries in the dais, all my students. I think at the outset, let me thank sir. I think this is something wonderful piece of history, and the way he really told us is something which is always a pleasure to listen and always a lot of introspect and learning from that. I always feel we give our life to these institutions. For 40 years, 45 years, we have been in these institutions. We love these institutions, not only walls, but also the people who work in this. And therefore, it is very important for us to know what happened and how the whole system is built there, what were the emotions, what were the systems, and what were the methods, errors, learnings which were there, which are again and again repeated. I think the story tells us that, yes, many of these things are repeated today. That time also, private practice has an effect onto the clinical practice, and today also we see some delay. That time also there was issues about the Marathi inclusion, and today also there are some issues like this. So I mean, so many things about an institution's reputation, but I personally feel institutions of this greatness survive because of the people who have constantly there act as pillars. Probably one person definitely you say made a difference on this, but many pillars of these institutions have really held this kind of forts for years together today. And that's the reason these institutions really survive. And it's worth learning from the history of these institutions. I think today only somebody asked me, where is the history of Mumbai and history of medical colleges? I think it's a right answer sir has given. Yes, there is a history, you have to know it, you have to learn it. And of course, you have to see that you probably do not make the same errors. Or we, how do we really cope up with that? So thank you very much sir, for making this. Thank you so much.
And now I request a discussion, Dr. Speaker, gentle to discuss it.
Respected Dr. Sunil Pandya and dear friends, it's a great honor and privilege to speak on an occasion which has been designed to commemorate the memory of Dr. Krishna Raj. I must admit that in my life I never met Dr. Krishna Raj, but if his writings in EPW are anything to go by, and if his students write up on him are anything to measure his quality, Dr. Krishna stands out as not only a very distinguished editor of EPW, but also a great teacher, a great mentor, a person who built up institutions, a person who was a very hard taskmaster, but beyond that, a superb human being. I'm also thrilled, excited, and must say palpably nervous that today I am sharing a dais with Dr. Sunil Pandya. All my life I have admired Dr. Sunil Pandya for not only being a very skilled neurosurgeon, I mean today you go into the any corner of the country and you would find hundreds of his surgeons who he has trained. But much beyond that, Sunil Pandya's love, which almost borders onto infatuation with the history of medicine, his passion for medical ethics, his passion for building doctor-patient relationship, and the wonderful essays and articles that he has written in the National Medical Journal of India and the Indian Medical Indian Journal of Medical Ethics on almost everything that ails the medical practice these days makes extremely wonderful reading. So I must admit, sir, that today sharing dais with you is almost sharing a 22-yard pitch with Virat Kohli, and someone who is making a debut with Virat Kohli makes one palpably nervous. Dr. Sanjay Nagaraj has already said about these lines. The gentleman here happens to be George Santayana. And Dr. Avinash Supe has already explained to you that why the history of medical schools is important. Medical schools are not bricks and mortars. Medical schools are not just floors and windows and doors and roofs and labs and tables and chairs and deans and medical superintendents' offices. There's much more beyond in the medical schools. And if a modern medical student has to understand what these medical schools are all about, who built those great institutions, how did they come about, what were the teaching troubles, how those teaching troubles were sorted out, and the kind of zeal, passion, enthusiasm that was displayed about not only 50 years, 100 years, 150, but 200 years ago by gentlemen. Well, it helps you in relating to the past, and it helps you understand what these institutions are really all about. And therefore, this quote has almost become a cliche. He has been quoted hundreds and thousands of times. But again, I would like to quote that those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat. And therefore, it's all the more important for we, the students of modern medicine, to understand how these institutions were conceived, how they were designed, how they were nurtured, and over the years, what happened to these wonderful institutions. Let me very briefly take you to the past, isn't it? And this slide would show you about 10 top institutions which were designed about, say, somewhere about 100 to 200 years back. In 1835, two medical schools in the country came into being, one in the Kolkata and another in Chennai. And soon, over the next about 50 to 100 years, we had medical institutions, the Grant Medical College, a school in Agra, one in Pondicherry, and in Lucknow, another in Chennai, Patna, and finally, St. GS Medical College and Kame Hospital. All these institutions came up. And please do remember that these institutions were conceived 100, 200 years ago. Try to understand the kind of circumstances in which these great people thought of making these institutions, the amount of energy that they injected in building these institutions, the amount of hard work that went in the creation of these institutions. And today, after 175 years, JJ Hospital, or after about, say, 95 years, Kame Hospital still continues to occupy the place in the top 10 medical schools in the country. It clearly indicates that a lot of efforts have gone in not only the creation of these medical institutions, but over the years, generations of medical students, teachers, faculty members, and healthcare professionals have really worked very, very hard to maintain the decorum of these institutions as well. Dr. Pandya's essay on history and genesis of JJ Hospital brings into fore these three gentlemen: Sir Robert Grant, Sir Jamsetjee, Jejeebhoy, and Dr. Charles Morehead. Dr. Robert Grant was the person who conceived the idea that yes, India needs a medical school. Dr. Jamsetjee, Jejeebhoy, Sir Jamsetjee, Jejeebhoy was a financier, and Dr. Charles Morehead then made sure that those plans were actually executed. I can well imagine about 200 years ago the kind of the bonhomie and the camaraderie which would exist to these three gentlemen, Grant, Jejeebhoy and Morehead. The kind of a teamwork which they must have done and the kind of a hard work that they did was really responsible for designing JJ Hospital. And if you would please permit me to draw an analogy from film industry, I would say that in the 1960s, the kind of a bond that existed between Raj Kapoor, Shailendra, Hasrat Jaipuri, Mukesh, and Shankar Jaikishan, and year after year, decade after decade, this gentleman kept on creating the wonderful movies, the same amount of zeal and passion probably existed between Grant, between Morehead, and Jamsetjee, Jejeebhoy. So all in all, it was a teamwork. It was not an individual who was creating an institution. It was a team of a like-minded person who not only gelled well, but shared a common chemistry, who designed and created these wonderful institutions. And as Dr. Sunil Pandya also told us, that today Grant is Grant, not only because of Sir Grant, but because of this gentleman called Nana Shankar Sheth. And the anecdote goes that Sir Robert Grant died even before the Grant Medical College came into being, and a meeting was organized to mourn his death. And in that meeting, this gentleman, Nana Shankar Sheth, suggested that let us make sure that this medical college is named after Sir Grant. And therefore, this gentleman is responsible for today making Grant what Grant really is. I'm also acutely conscious of a wonderful philanthropy and charity that existed about 200 years ago. Dr. Pandya has already explained to us that 100,000 rupees in those days was a princely sum. It's almost, if you compound this money to about say 12% annual interest, compounded annually, it almost is 500 crore rupees today in 2018. And single gentleman, Sir Jamsetjee, Jejeebhoy, donating this princely sum without any strings attached to it, without expecting anything in return, is a great contribution. And if you look at the history of several medical schools in the country, whether it's the Topiwala National Medical College, where Dr. M. N. Desai and Dr. A. L. Nair contributed a great deal, not only in terms of the land that they donated, the funds that they created, the money they brought in, for the GS Medical College, the wonderful contribution of Gordandas Sundardas Trust. And there's a big story. I would have liked Dr. Sunil Pandya to tell the story, how this Gordandas Sundardas Trust came into being, and how this money was donated to build this great institution. Even CMC Vellore, in 1900, when Ida Spedder gets $10,000 from an unknown person somewhere in the United States of America, who goes on to build the CMC Vellore, and the wonderful contribution of Sir Durabji Tata in building Tata Memorial Hospital, and from the very institution that I am coming from, Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Medical Sciences, Sevagram, the kind of a funding that we received from two persons, Ghanshyam Das Birla, who asked Dr. Sushil Nair to construct a 15-bedded hospital for mother and children, and a huge amount of a land that was donated by Jamnalalji Bajaj. And over the years now, that land was used by Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Medical Sciences, Sevagram. They are wonderful examples of absolutely pure philanthropy and charity. And if we contrast that philanthropy and charity about 1500 or say 200 years ago with the current philanthropy, we find that today the charity is governed, dictated, and driven by something in return. Many times when we ask for an appeal for funding for our own institution, the first question that we are asked is that Do you have section 80G or do you have section 135(1)(b)? Because we will get some tax exemptions out of that. So that is the first question that is asked. The government is today making people donate money because there is a corporate social responsibility. So it is not coming voluntarily, but this money is being donated simply because the government is asking that you must pass an X portion of your annual profits that you earn every year to a social cause. So again, it's not something which is coming from you. And every time you get a donation, there are tons and tons of strings attached. There's a sense of ownership, there is a sense of a kind of a feeling that, well, I'm giving this money to your institution, so directly or indirectly, I'm connected with your institution, and so on. And if you look at the funding of the corporate hospitals, there are dozens of corporate hospitals in the country have come up. And these corporate hospitals now got a land at a throwaway price from the government. The instrument that they imported were heavily subsidized because the moment you get these grants, now you also get a concession in the import duty. And year after year, decade after decade, isn't it, they also got huge benefits in a reduction in income tax. But is any of these corporate hospitals today really designed to reduce the suffering of the poor, the rural, the downtrodden? All these hospitals have been designed in big cities. They are all corporate, not 7-star, but even 10-star mega hospitals, which have been designed to make sure that only 1%, and even I think 1% is also an overestimate, a very small fraction of the population would probably be able to get an accessible or an affordable healthcare from these corporate hospitals. So the distinction between the philanthropy that existed about 100 years ago, which was absolutely selfless philanthropy, and the philanthropy and charity and funding which is occurring in the healthcare today is absolutely contrasting to even a naked eye. I learned from Dr. Pandya's talk that what kind of methodology went in when JJ started choosing students. He said that the students would come from any caste or creed, religion is no bar, caste is no bar. They should be aged between 16 and 20. They should be fluent in English. They tested their grammar, they tested their syntax. They were also made to obtain a certificate from their headmasters of a good conduct. But what is very interesting is that when the exams were conducted to choose these medical students, these potential aspirants of the medical school, they were tested on John Milton's Paradise Lost. And this Paradise Lost was a textbook for the undergraduates, and probably even 200 years ago, the British were not only testing the knowledge in English, but also were also testing some soft skills, some interest in art, interest in literature, that when these medical students, when these potential medical students were chosen. Dr. Pandya has also explained a great deal about how even before William Osler was born, these medical students were taught the bedside medicine and the great importance of bedside medicine in shaping this medical student's career. Today's medical students might as well counter ask me that, well, the students were taught bedside medicine because bedside medicine was the only medicine that existed 200 years ago. The ECG machine was not born, the X-ray was not invented, the ultrasounds and CTs and MRIs and EMGs and ENGs were not there, the modern labs were not there. So what else they could do except the only practicing bedside medicine? But we must remember, that the bedside medicine was relevant about 200 years ago. The bedside medicine continues to be relevant 200 years later, simply because that it is this bedside medicine, it is this wonderful doctor-patient relationship that we build. It is that rapport that we build with our patients that helps us a great deal in becoming highly successful practitioners of healthcare. So what was that in JJ? 175 years. What is that in KEM? Almost 100 years now, isn't it? That has enabled them to preserve their vision and mission for almost more than a century. Well, as I said, that they're all hollow buildings, isn't it? And you don't make medical schools from this brick and mortar, isn't it? Here I'm listing only a handful of teachers, who taught Dr. Sunil Pandya. And if you read Dr. Sunil Pandya's essays in National Medical Journal of India or Indian Medical Ethics and several other journals, he became acutely conscious of the esteem with which he holds his teachers. So here are Dr. Setna, Dr. Mehta, Dr. Wagle, Dr. Saraiya, Dr. Noshi Wadia, his own guide, Dr. Gajendra Singh and Vijay Dave, Dr. Noshi Antia, Dr. Salun, Dr. Sulake, and Dr. Dastur. And each of these teachers was a stalwart. Each of his teachers taught a wonderful medicine. They led a team of doctors and they exemplified what a modern medicine should be all about. And they probably had all the virtues which are associated with a good teacher. They not only taught their subjects well, but had real interest in their students and went beyond their calling and vocation to make sure that is really, really, really understood by the students. So one of the great tradition of whether it's JJ or AEM is that both these medical schools were gifted with wonderful teachers that time. This is a picture which has been cited and which has been almost hundreds of thousands of times all over the world. Commissioned in 1890, this picture by Luke exemplifies what Luke Gills exemplifies what a good doctor should be all about and what how wonderful a doctor-patient relationship can be. So here is a doctor, he's a senior doctor, visiting a patient's home, seeing a small child in a very poor conditions and looking very intently at the sick child and trying to figure out how best he can restore this child's health. And this is what a doctor-patient relationship was about, say 50 years ago, 100 years ago, or 200 years ago, where the doctors were really interested in the patient's well-being and where the patient's interest and whether the patient's health was of paramount importance so far as the doctors was concerned. I'm also reminded of a 1997 movie, Titanic. And here is Kate Winslet, and the hero of the movie. And you can see the eyes of Kate, isn't it? The open arms she's displaying, and she says that, "I trust you." In fact, the dialogue in the movie says, "I trust you." And that was a kind of a trust, a bond that existed between the doctors and the patients in that era, where the patients had completely, almost a blind faith in their doctors and thought that whatever the doctors would do, it would be in their best interest. Gone are the days where the doctors and patients have become now mutually suspicious of each other, where the doctors are no longer called doctors and the patients are no longer called patients, and the names have changed. But probably this kind of a relationship existed in JJ and AEM in those wonderful days. Let me fast forward you today and let me talk a bit about what are the medical schools and what they are doing today. If you ask the Medical Council of India, and yesterday only we suddenly found that the Medical Council of India has been abolished, isn't it, and has been replaced by seven wise gentlemen, and let's expect a great deal from these seven wise men and women there. But what are the functions of a medical school? And very broadly speaking, even a layman would tell us that the function of a medical school is to design high quality doctors who are responsive to the felt or voiced or unvoiced concerns of the community in which they are practicing. It's very simple. So all that I need is a doctor who should be able to take care of my health, and the kind of a healthcare that they provide me should be A, affordable, be accessible, and see appropriate. So the aims and objectives of designing a medical school and running a medical school are very simple. And over the years we find that right now, as of today, there are 497 medical colleges, and probably as we go home, this number might swell to and cross 500, the way the medical schools are rapidly proliferating. In fact, the closest analogy that I can use to describe this rampant proliferation of medical schools is a kidney disease called RPGN, the rapidly proliferative glomerulonephritis, and these schools are multiplying almost like a cancerous growth in this institute. In 1995, if you look at the data, we find that there were only 129 government medical colleges and there were only 47 private medical colleges. And fast forward this data to 2018 and you find that the private medical schools have overtaken government medical schools. The government medical schools have only doubled today. They are only 229. And the private medical schools have grown fivefold. They have grown to now 267. Which means that the entire medical education today is at the mercy of a private sector. And the private sector is going to govern, decide the kind of doctors which are going to emerge from the portal of this institution. It's going to decide what healthcare this country receives, and it's going to have a big, big impact, not only about the quality of medical education, but in general about the quality of healthcare that we will be practicing. And this year, 1980, happens to be a landmark year in the history of medical schools in the country, because till this year, most medical schools were private. Most medical schools were government. There were a handful of medical schools which were, say, private, like, say, CMC Vellore or MGIMS Sevagram and so on, which were not exactly private in the true sense of the word, because they were governed by some trust whose main motive was to make sure that we really offer an affordable and appropriate healthcare to the rural and underprivileged population. But come 1980, and we suddenly find that the private sector has completely overtaken the public sector. The money which is going into the public sector is getting diminished year by year, not only in medical schools, but also in public health there. And we find that this huge gap between the public sector and private sector is increasing almost year after year. So what are the problems here? Dr. Supe has written an editorial about 2 years back about the evolution of medical education in India, co-authored by Dr. Anshu, who comes from my own institution. And Dr. Supe laments that, well, there is an asymmetry of medical schools. If the medical schools are being created, the simple notion that because the doctor-to-patient ratio in our country is very poor, if we create more medical schools, we design more doctors, and probably doctors who are coming out from the portals of these medical schools would probably go to the underprivileged, rural, and poor areas. Well, that is not happening, because most of these medical schools are coming in big cities. Most of these medical schools are being created by private sector. And the amount of a fee, even after the introduction of NEET, that you have to pay to get an admission in these private medical schools is something which even an upper middle class person cannot afford if he has to shell out this money pure white from his or her pocket. So merely even if you double or triple the number of medical schools over the 10 years, the kind of an inaccessibility to the healthcare is going to remain in the country, and just opening new medical schools is not an answer. The way the students are being selected today in the medical schools, which is an entirely a big topic, and I won't address that topic today. And there are curricula, because our curricula are very poorly designed. We are trying to make a basic doctor today, but if you ask a generation of medical students today, nobody wants to become a basic doctor. Nobody wants to stop at MBBS, isn't it? The career aspiration of every medical student here is getting a good MD and MS. They don't stop there. They're getting a good DM or an MCH. They don't stop there, but getting some fellowship there and then doing a good quality work. So today, if you ask them, today if you force them that, well, we want to design a good quality first contact physician, isn't it, and we will stop at MBBS level, well, probably what you have in mind and what is in the mind of a younger generation is a completely loggerheads. And about the teaching in the medical schools these days, well, the less said the better. The old timers often lament that what the students come in the medical school, they crack physics, chemistry, biology, stop there. They get 99% marks, enter the medical school. In the medical school, they have become experts in cracking multiple choice questions. So today, if you ask a medical student, isn't it, who is about to take a pre-PG NEET, what happens, what syndrome results when the short arm of chromosome 13 breaks down? Well, he will be able to answer this question even before your question ends. But if you ask him that, how do you palpate a spleen, or how do you discover the beauty of early diastolic murmur of aortic regurgitation, or why do the lungs crackle, or why do the bronchi wheeze, or why do the pupils dilate, or why does the plantar go up? Well, they have no idea, because today the medical students have not only stopped coming to the classes, and this is all over the country, the medical students have now stopped coming to the classes. The bedside medical clinics no longer attract these medical students, because they are no longer interested in those nuances of history, the physical examination, making diagnosis by history and physical examination, constructing a differential diagnosis, and that huge orgasm that you get by making a diagnosis by your own hands, by your own words, that no longer kills them. All that is obsessing their mind. And in my own institution, MDMS Sevagram, when I interview the third year, fourth year, and final year medical students, I find that at least half the class is terribly frustrated. It is disappointed. It is turning cynic. The pangs of anxiety is creating nightmares in these medical students. And at least 20% of the medical students often wonder that did they make a mistake by taking a wrong profession? Probably this was not something in their mind. Probably this is not a kind of a doctor that they wanted to be. And exam after exam, year after year, that sword of an uncertainty about getting a PG admission has completely destroyed the charm of a medicine. So the bedside medicines are no longer what the bedside medicine used to be. The classrooms are no longer where a teacher would come and would lecture the students about an hour about cirrhosis or a portal hypertension or a stroke or a diabetic retinopathy or a fractured neck femur. Well, those days have completely lost. And today, if you ask an intern after doing an internship whether he or she has learned those practical skills of doing a lumbar puncture or a pleural tap or a venesection or assisting in an appendix operation or doing a normal liver, well, they would say that, well, all that they did is that, well, they were cracking multiple choice questions. They have already joined the coaching classes, and although their body is in the ward, well, their heart lies and their mind is in that coaching classes. So if today the medical student is not interested in what is being taught to him or her, isn't it? If he or she is not interested in learning the soft skills of medical profession, and if today the old timers blame that where is history or ethics or art or science or music or philosophy or a doctor-patient relationship, the answer is, well, that these things don't help us. These things don't help us in getting an admission in a postgraduate program. So if I devote these times to learning the soft skills, learning the proper bedside medicine, I would be reduced to acquire only an MBBS degree, and I would not be able to get a post-graduation anywhere. So the emphasis of the medical students has completely been diverted to now opting in their postgraduate, and that opting in a post-graduation today has become extremely hard. The second point has occurred to have no takers. You look at those 50-odd medical schools in Maharashtra, there are no takers in anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, forensic medicine, microbiology, and very few seats would go to the pharmacology. I shudder. About 10 years or 15 years afterwards, there won't be any teacher now left in basic sciences. And if there are no teachers left in basic sciences, how are our students going to get those foundations in medical in basic sciences? Dr. Pandya talks about 123 lectures devoted to anatomy, 111 lectures devoted to chemistry 200 years ago, but here we have no teachers in basic sciences. So the very foundation on which clinical medicine and surgery is built, that foundation is very weak, it's very getting eroded, and probably the future generation today will have to pay a very heavy price for the kind of a system that we are designing and implementing. I won't touch this slide again. We know that what happens in the private world and what's happening there. And I've already explained to you what's happening after post-NEET. And I welcome NEET because NEET probably gave us a guarantee that we will inject some kind of an objectivity, we'll inject some kind of a transparency in the selection of a medical student, isn't it? And probably the rampant corruption which is occurring in the private medical schools, the hundreds and thousands and lakhs and crores of rupees that they are giving to the private medical schools to grab a degree in radiology or psychiatry or dermatology would probably go. But we must ask ourselves that are we really getting good doctors by creating a system which probably brings about an objectivity and transparency and gets rid of subjectivity and the financial aspect? Probably the need has terribly failed so far as this aspect is concerned.
Dr.
Dr. Pandya touched a raw point about reservations and all these write-ups. I often get an impression that of the 5 points that he has listed, the 5 ills which are now plaguing the medical schools, now reservation happens to be one of those. I agree with him to an extent that merit and only merit should be a criteria for fostering a quality medical education. But I must also admit from my own experience of working in a rural medical school that let us not equate only merit with excellence there. I would rather have a resident who is slightly mediocre but has soft values, isn't it, of empathy, compassion and a concern for a patient, isn't it, and who is willing to put in long hours rather than a highly brilliant student who is probably 3 standard deviations outside because this student is never going to help me. It's more often than not, you are the kind of a students who often emerge from the top medical schools in the country and often end up either as consultants in quote-unquote corporate private hospitals or they go abroad. How many of such highly brilliant students have ever worked in underprivileged rural areas, have shown a concern for the poor patients? I don't think that you're an example. From my own students, from my own residents who belong to the reserved category, I often find that not only did they excel in studies and outsmarted the people coming from open categories, but went on to go to their own native places and small villages and went to the very small places where the healthcare is either not accessible or not affordable and are providing excellent service so far as their felt needs are concerned. And therefore, this is one point, Dr. Pandya, don't agree. Yeah. Another point is the tremendous cost of a medical education. If you look at medical education today, it has become very, very expensive. Just yesterday, I calculated that my parents spent when I graduated and obtained my MD medicine from Government Medical College, Nagpur, between 1973 and 1981. And I calculated those eight years, my parents paid 720 rupees, which included my entire undergraduate education, my internship, and my MD program also. 720 rupees, because those days we used to pay 12 rupees for our 12 rupees per month as our tuition fees, and 12 rupees per month as our semester fees, as our hostel fees. Isn't it? So in 720 rupees, I became an MD doctor. Today, the economists might argue that the medical education was terribly subsidized. It's very important that the medical students must pay some amount of fees there. But the kind of fees that have rocketed in the last 10 years, well, probably nobody would be able to become a good doctor. Today, the parents have to pay from their own pockets. You see, I am talking about government medical colleges as well, and about the private medical colleges, the less sentimental. I strongly believe that the medical care is a social cause, and it is a moral and ethical obligation of the central and state government that they must fund, the medical education, and they must fund public health as well. So, if today the government of India spends only just 1%, barely 1% of its GDP on health, and today tries to make an effort that let's have a private public blending, and is trying to divert the onus of providing healthcare to the private sector, probably the government of India and the state governments are probably shying away from their constitutional responsibilities, from their moral and ethical obligations, and it's high time all work together to make sure that the government realizes that it is their responsibility to fund the medical education. So, another 3 or 4 minutes. Dr. Sunil Pandya explained to you about the art and science of medicine. He traces the journey of JJ Hospital and says that it was on the old days, the foremost and one of the best medical schools. That it was unique in its origin, in its design, in its objectivity, in its philosophy, in the way it has been functioning there. And then laments, where are all those soft virtues gone? Where is humility? Where is humanity? where is honesty in the medical profession now? And he often wonders in several of his write-ups that medicine is no more a calling or a vocation. In other words, I often find that Dr. Pandya almost identifying himself with the medicine of 60s and 70s, isn't it? Almost getting infatuated with that medicine and saying that the great teachers, great students, great patients, wonderful doctor-patient relationship, everything was built on trust, on faith, on science, and suddenly in the last, say, 20, 30 years, everything has probably gone rotten. I'm reminded of this gentleman, Socrates. And Socrates wrote, in his own time, this famous quote, isn't it? Where we again explain that how every generation, isn't it? After a certain period of time, now finds that the descendants of the second generation is not as good as the former generation. I'm reminded of my residence in medicine. But as soon as the first year medicine resident turns the second year, suddenly they start telling me that, sir, nowadays these students don't work. They don't attend OPDs. They don't attend calls. Often they are not traceable. They don't pick up their mobiles. In the middle of the night, they don't write down the case histories. They don't investigate the patients anymore, isn't it? So really, the system is getting rotten. And remember that this I have been hearing for the last 35 years. And I often wonder that if each generation now starts casting aspersions on its second generation, isn't it? By this time, the MGM as my own institution should have come to a grinding halt. The very fact that it is still alive and kicking, isn't it? And the patients continue to get satisfaction with their residents, with their faculty members, is a proof that probably we are making a lot of judgmental. Probably. It's not right. I am reminded of Sunil Chandi, who was a principal of Christian Medical College, Vellore, and who traced the history of Christian Medical College, Vellore, who wrote in a recent book which Sanjay Nagar edited. And he said that the original vision of any large institution lasts for 40 years. In other words, the half-life of any major institution is about 20 years, and after that, this institution starts decaying. So how do we prevent that decay? How do we make sure that, well, the role would only rise and would never fall? Well, Sunil Chandi has as an answer that you must change without altering your original vision or mission. So if your medical school or hospital was designed to make sure that students get quality education and the patients get an affordable, accessible and appropriate healthcare, you must be conscious of that fact. But make sure that with the time you also change, isn't it? And that change, that continuity with change might sound an oxymoron, but if these modern institutions have to live with these changing times, we must understand that a society is constantly changing, the society is constantly evolving, and it is high time that we also change with the changing society. The older generation always believes that in our bad old days, everything was hunky-dory. Great teachers, great administrators, great doctors, highly skilled surgeons, wonderful doctor-patient relationships, etc. So they are probably referring to this graph, skewed distribution. Now they lament that, well, everything is rotten, everything, and they refer to this graph on this side. But we must remember, statistics tell us, the numbers tell us that a society is always normally distributed. Which means that most of us are lying in the middle. There are exceptional ones like Dr. Sunil Pandya who might lie 3 standard deviations outside, and there are few who are scoundrels and who are dirty sheets in the medical profession. But probably 60 or 70% would probably lie in the middle, and would probably the mean or a median would be somewhere here. So it's rather important that instead of talking those exceptions, 3 standard deviations outside is 1%, and 1% very good and 1% very bad. We must remember that even today in government medical colleges, when most doctors now would occupy a place within a 1 standard deviation of the graph. And so, I must tell you, sir, that all is not lost. there are beacons of hope. We are the very government institutions which have produced people like Dr. Abhay and Rani Pam, like Prakash and Vikas Amke, like Avinash and Kavita Sato, Yogesh Jain and Raman Kataria, Vinayak Sen. Where did they come from? They come from these very government institutions. The very fact that over the years they have made a tremendous impact so far as the people's life is concerned, had emerged as role models, is a testimony that all is not lost in the government medical schools, and this in every batch will find an exceptional medical students who would belong to the same cadre with the distinguished names. So I would end by a 1958 movie, Jab Subah Hogi. And those lines by Sahir Ludhiani, picturized by Raj Kapoor and Nargis. They are very strong on my mind. Where Raj Kapoor says that, yes, wo subah kabhi to aaye. And sir, I would like to read those lines. वो सुबह कभी तो आएगी इन काली सदियों के सर से जब रात का आंचल ढलकेगा जब अंबर झूम के नाचेगी जब धरती नगमे गाएगी वो सुबह कभी तो आएगी. थैंक यू.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर फॉर दिस एक्सीलेंट एंड इंटरेस्टिंग डिस्कशन ऑन द टॉपिक. May I now request Dr. Pandya, Dr. Kalendri, Dr. Nagaraj, and Dr. Supri to please take seats on the dais. Now I request the dignitaries to accept our token of appreciation and gratitude. May I request Dr. Padma Prakash, founder of ESS and founder trustee of Anusandhan, to offer our token of appreciation. I request Dr. Padma to offer our token of appreciation to Dr. Sunil Pandya. I request Dr. Ravi Duggal, the trustee of Anusandhan Trust, to offer the token of appreciation to Dr. Sanjay Nagraj. And Dr. Avinash Sukhi. Thank you. I request Dr. Lopa Mehta ma'am to propose the vote of thanks.
Let me just speak first about our students, because they are really truly beacon of hope. They are so wonderful. What they are waiting is for some direction whereby they can go to the right path. In fact, just before I came here, I just told Dr. Sunil Pandya, because one of the students phoned me up and he had done some work which was not otherwise expected out of him. So please, I'm assuring on behalf of all our students to all the dignitaries that whenever they would need medical practice, they will be in good hands. They are very sincere. Only thing is that they need direction, so it is our responsibility to give them direction. Coming to today's event, we have our archives named Janus, where we have put up as much as you can see backwards, that much you can see forward. So Dr. Sunil Pandya has very clearly brought out what it is to know past if we want to create our future. Thank you very much. Dr. Kalanjari, I am with you. I am sure we will have better and better future, because history is not made by a giants. They are made by small steps taken by different people at different levels. So everyone will have, we all need to part from here with assurance in your last slide. Thank you very much, Dr. Supesh. He has been always encouraging for every activity which is held in this institution and even outside. So thank you very much. And Dr. Sanjay Nagral, I don't think he feels away from this place. He feels part of this institution. So thank you very much for introducing everyone. And now finally, I would like to thank Swarupa for doing a wonderful job. And I must admire all the people who work so diligently for Cehat, because the way they have chased me, I know that they mean everything to be done so precisely. So to Cehat, and of course eSocial Sciences and Forum for Medical Ethics, and most important, all of the entire audience, especially sitting in the later half. And thank you very much for making this event. Somewhere I think you will go home with something registered at the back, and you will come back. And of course, I can't omit all these important people sitting here who have really given, embellished this event. Thank you very much. And as a climax to this, nice snacks awaiting outside. Thank you.